Victoria celebrated Freedom Day on Friday, following in the epidemiological or public health management footsteps of neighbouring New South Wales and ACT. This is how Delta case numbers have tracked in Australia over the last few months.
Cases in New South Wales started rising in late June. A few dozen daily cases quickly became a few hundred. On September 3rd, daily cases in the state peaked at more than 1,500. But almost as quickly as case numbers grew, they've dropped off. There's been a steady decline in New South Wales, so that at the beginning of this week, new cases were in the low 200s. In Victoria, the surge in cases started about a month after New South Wales. Numbers followed a very similar trajectory, rising up to more than 2,200 a day. The speed of the growth in cases does appear to have slowed, but it's not yet clear whether numbers have peaked.
So, what can New Zealand glean from the last few months of the Australian response? Professor Mary-Louise McLaws from the University of New South Wales is with us this morning. Kia ora, welcome to Q&A. Looking at the Australian experience and how things stand in New Zealand at the moment, what should we expect here?
Good morning. Look, I think you should expect that unless your 90% is equitable, that is regionally, culturally, and by age, that what you will see are clusters of infection. And they won't just be mild, like we've seen in Singapore, where they opened up, they had about, you know, in the 70% vaccine coverage, but they've gone from about 180 infections in that first week, you know, to over 3,000, about 3,900 only a few days ago. But most of those were mild infections, about, 90-odd percent are mild. But in regional Australia, they may not be mild because they haven't had equity of access. And so you want to learn from our mistakes. And just looking at who drives, inadvertently, of course, not deliberately, infection in New Zealand, you know, the 0 to 39-year-olds are 72% of all cases. So the young ones need to have vaccine equity. And it's really, really important. And at the moment, that 20 to 39-year-olds, only 55 have been fully vaccinated. Mm. And the Maori group, you know, only 47% have been. The Pacificas, only 61%. And, you know, of course, you know, the remote regional areas around New Zealand, it may take at least 50 to 60 minutes to get to a vaccine hub. So what you should learn from Singapore and from particularly Victoria coming up and our regional areas is if you don't want to see infections that won't be mild necessarily in a naive group that haven't been vaccinated or, and that haven't had any natural infection antibodies, you really do need to take the vaccine to the people, to the remote areas.
Is there reason for hope in the New South Wales response? We saw those numbers surge and then drop off. They've plateaued somewhat. Will that trend continue?
That trend will continue, I believe. But what the authorities did quite sensibly is walk back a decision to open up to regional areas when they realised that us in the city could inadvertently take infection to somewhere like Hunter, New England, that was struggling with some infection rates and the highest in the regional areas, or our Indigenous First Nations population out in the West weren't well covered. Some were brilliantly covered and some weren't. So they walked back that decision, and we are not allowed to go yet to some regional areas, and quite rightly so. So you should learn from our original mistake that we could have made it worse, but fortunately, we haven't seen that yet.
And what do you think of the New Zealand government's plan?
Look, I think the 90% idea should be congratulated. You know, New Zealand is very conservative around how to handle COVID, quite rightly. But what I'd like to see is you to learn from not just Australia, but from overseas. Nearly every country fails to understand who the drivers are. And, you know, they go for the compassionate rollout for vaccines to the elderly. Absolutely. And the elderly in New Zealand have very little attack rate within their age group, but they certainly get hospitalized a lot. But what you do need to do is focus on the young and get them vaccinated, regardless of their culture and regardless of where they live. Make sure the young get vaccinated so you will stop the drive. Yeah. And make sure, particularly that 20 to 39, do get to 90 as well. And one other thing, if you wouldn't mind me suggesting, is that the school children are doing well but are not vaccinated highly enough yet, at about 49% double vaccinated, and only about 29% having their first one. Fantastic. You know, they're close to 80%, but why not wait for them to go back to school for when they're at 90%? And that way you buffer the young who can't get vaccinated yet.
That's interesting, because senior students in Auckland, where most of New Zealand's infections are occurring, return to school for in-person learning this week. Is that a mistake, do you think?
Look, I understand that authorities and parents want their kids back to school because they see the difference. You know, the socialising is important. However, so is their health. And while they mainly get mild infection, about 2% of children can go to hospital. And so, you know, 2% as the numbers just increase in children is a large number eventually. So why not protect them? And also, when kids are sick and they stay away from school, they often feel bad about themselves that they can't keep up with their schoolwork. So keep them at home until they're 90%, and then you've got a very safe childhood.
In Auckland, we're in a curious position of having vaccination rates relatively high compared to most of New Zealand, but we also have higher infection rates as well. Would it be reasonable to ease some of those border restrictions around Auckland once we get vaccination coverage of 90% for the eligible population?
Look, it seems reasonable, doesn't it? But what happens if you open up that sort of ring fencing of Auckland and allow people to go outside of Auckland to areas where they aren't well vaccinated? Now, you could do that if you really had a system that could police it, and so that they could ensure that those that leave are double vaccinated and they have a certificate. And that needs to be checked, because you don't want to put people in regional areas, particularly remote communities that haven't had enough vaccine, at great risk, because while double vaccination keeps us from dying, from being hospitalized, it doesn't always keep us from being uninfected and having silent infection and then taking it to remote areas.